Statistics Unit Section 2, Measures of Variability. To help us introduce this, we have this youngster who's willing to wade across this pond because he's told that the average depth is 4.2 feet. That doesn't sound too bad to him, so he gives it a go. And as we see, the cross-sectional depths range from 3 feet to a maximum of 5 feet, so he's okay. Here, the youngster is considered crossing another small pond and is told that once again the average depth is 4.2 feet. Since he was successful the first time, he's willing to give it a go. While all of this is very silly, it gets the point across that knowing only about central tendencies, mean, in this case, doesn't always paint a complete picture. You need to know more to get a fuller understanding of a collection of data. If you see here, this case had the same mean, but we have a maximum depth of 14 feet, and that's where this boy got in trouble. So it's important that we know something about the variability. Even though we know mean, median, mode, we need to take a look. And variability refers to how different the data values are from one another. In this example, the numbers are rather similar, so we would say the variability is very low. We also would say that the numbers are very consistent. In another illustration of variability, here we have a different set of numbers. We have a low of 2 and a high of 91. As you can guess, the variability is higher because the numbers aren't similar, and also the values are not consistent in size because of the larger spread. Another example to illustrate variability, if you were asked the question, who's the better bowler, and we were given just the mean scores for each one, most of us would select bowler B. But if the question was, who is more consistent, to make that determination, we need to see the scores to decide whether there's a similarity to these scores. So we now have that information, and to answer the question, who is more consistent, we're looking at numbers that are similar to one another. Bowler A, as you can see, has poor nights and very good nights, where bowler B is very consistent and similar with the scoring. So we would say bowler B is the more consistent here. If you were given these two score cards for these individuals and ask who is the more consistent golfer, because there's so many, it's going to make it a much more difficult job. So we have some tools that help us with the measure of variability. And the first one is range. It's a very simple calculation. It's a statistical measure of variability that we can use to quantify the amount of variability in a data set. Instead of just saying it's smaller or greater, we have an actual formula. And it's found by taking the highest number in the data set minus the lowest number. Here we have an example of gas prices in Madison, Wisconsin. The highest and the lowest given, so to determine the range value, we'll take the highest, $1.99, and subtract the lowest, $1.72.9, to get a range of 18 cents. A small range means that the data values are very similar. A large range means that the data values are dissimilar. And to know whether, in this example, 18 cents is small or large, we would need to repeat this over a period of time to know what would be the typical variation between the numbers. A further measure of variability is standard deviation, and we'll take a look at that in a bit. Here's an example of calculating variability. The question is, who is the more consistent golfer? We have scores for both, and we'll use the range value to make that decision. On golfer A, the high score is 96, low is 72, with a difference of 24 for the range value. For golfer B, we have a low of 76 and a high of 82. The range is the difference between those two values, which is 6, and for the more consistent golfer, then it would be the one with the smallest range. So golfer B would be our choice. For additional practice on finding range, look at practice set 5. There are some drawbacks with determining range. Here's an example: which blueprint reading student has the least variability in their test scores. We, similar to the golf course example, we would calculate the range. So here we have student A's test scores, we have student B's test scores. Determining the range, we identify the highest and the lowest, or smallest and largest, gives us a 30 for student A, and turns out a range of 30 for student B. Seems like initially that these two students have the same consistency. However, if you look at the values of student A, all of them are in the 90s with the exception of this one score. This would be considered an outlier, not consistent with the rest of them. So using the range as a measure of variability would be a little misleading, and perhaps there's a better method that we can use. If we take that outlier out, we now have a range of 6, and we would definitively say student A is more consistent or has the least variability in their test scores. As a review of the first two sections, we had the measures of central tendencies listed here. Here's a student with some test scores. How good is this student? Well, we could calculate each one of those measures of central tendencies. To determine how consistent they are, we have our two measures of variability. And determining whether these scores are similar to one another, the range by taking the largest minus the smallest is 25. And to be covered soon, the standard deviation ends up being 8.5. Is that small or is it large? Again, you'd need something to compare that to for that answer. Here's the casual definition for a standard deviation. It describes the average distance a typical piece of data is from the middle of the data set. It tells us how much that data differs from the mean, and it's a good measure of variability because all of the individual pieces of data are used in calculating it. We saw just a minute ago where using the range to determine the consistency or the measure of variability when an outlier is in there can definitely skew the results. Here we have student A. If you calculate the mean, we have a 70.3, and here's a graphical representation of what standard deviation is measuring. Here's our mean, and here are the scores of the student. And what we're looking for is what the size or the average of the distance from each one of those scores is going to be. So as you can see, they're spread out quite a ways. We would expect a greater variability here. And when we average those values, we have an average distance of 9.1. Again, with one isolated incident, it's kind of hard to decide, is this a large standard deviation or not? Well, let's look at another example. Here we have student B. Calculate the average. The mean here is 70.3. But when we look at how each of these scores compares to that mean or average, you can see they're much closer together, more consistent, less variability. So it has a smaller standard deviation and is more consistent. When we average these distance, we end up with an average distance of 3.3. Both of these students had the same mean value, but student B has the lower average distance, which is technically what our standard deviation is measuring, using all of the numbers in the calculation rather than the range, giving us a more reliable number or truer number for the measure of variability. To compute the standard deviation, you can use a calculator. On page 21 in your textbook, it goes through the steps for calculating it with just a regular basic model calculator. A scientific calculator has functions built within it where there's special keys that will calculate the standard deviation for you once you enter the data values in. Other options are to use a computer where you could use the Excel spreadsheet program, and once those values are entered into a spreadsheet, you can use the standard deviation command to give you the standard deviation for a set of numbers. You also can use websites or apps to calculate standard deviation, and here's a couple examples as well. For additional practice, turn to page 22 in your book.